야, 자, 콩이 있다, 씨앗이다. 콩, 우리는 자꾸 콩 자체가 싹을 내서 어떻게 해요? 그렇죠? 그게 아니다, 이 말이다. 씨앗 자체가 활동을 하며 잎이 저절로 나타나도록 법칙이, 하나님이 그렇게 법칙을 제정해서, 법칙이 제정되어 있는 것이라고 상상해서는 안 된다. 그렇게 생각하면 거기서부터 우리 자신 속에 힘이 있는 거죠. 내재하는 능력이 있는 거죠.
First selected messages, page 294. First selected messages, page 294. It is not to be supposed that a law is not set in motion for the seed to work itself, that the leaf appears because it must do so of itself. God has laws that He has instituted, but they are only the servants through which He efforts, which He effects results. It is through the immediate agency of God that every tiny seed breaks through the earth and springs into life. Every leaf grows, every flower blooms by the power of God. 104. The seed has in itself a germinating principle, a principle that God Himself has implanted. Yet it left to itself, the seed would have no power to spring up. That was Education 104. Yet it left to itself, the seed would have no power to spring up. Yes, God is very busy. Another First Selected Messages, page 294 again. The physical organism of man is under the supervision of God, but it is not like a clock, which is set in operation and must go of itself. The heart beats, pulse succeeds pulse, breath succeeds breath, but the entire being is under the supervision of God. That's what it says.
Don't worry about it. Don't think ethically. If ethics enter into the body, it is very strange. For example, bokugi라는 새들은, 보셨죠? 그 뼈꾸기들은 자기가
Well, answer, to answer your question, let me give you this example. You know this bird? There's a bird. These birds, they don't make their nests, but then they lay their eggs in other birds' nests. One egg. They lay their one egg in other birds' nests. Now let's say, you know, in other birds' nests, there are four eggs. Let's say, you know, other nests, they have four eggs. And when this bird lays its own egg, one egg, you know, it does something to look similar to the other four legs. Do you think this is what the bird's doing it?
것이 하나님이 개입하신다는 그 사고 방식으로 지금 거의 바뀌어 있어요.
Well, for me, I've been struggling a lot. So for me, everything is done by the Lord. So when I watch TV, you know, I say, wow, God is so powerful. You know, God knew which nest this bird is going to go and lay its eggs. So the birds, the eggs inside of this bird, you know, God changed the colors, you know, to look similar to that nest's birds. And you know, the other birds, they didn't know that it was that bird's babies. Anyways, they took care of these eggs and they got hatched. And then, you know, four eggs and this one egg here. You know, by the way, this bird's egg hatched first. And that bird pushes away those other four eggs before they're hatched. One and two and three, and they push away all those four eggs. When you watch that TV, you know, you should, yeah, there is God. And they should stop here. If there's no God, you know, it just can't happen. Remember the sermons? They follow their own course. When the scientists say, you know, the salmons have their own course, then you should think that, ah, there is God, and God is controlling over. And God is letting people know that God exists. You know, that's the effort of God. But then scientists say, well, they know their own way. Well, turtles know their own way. But we shouldn't, as a Christian, we shouldn't think that way. You know, your question was, you know, why? The question was, why the lions want to eat the rabbits if there is God? Well, you shouldn't think in a moral way only. Okay, and this is my answer. Again, go back to my story again. I just told you about the question that Sang Lee was answering. Now, I was having this seminar in America. There are about 120 people. You know, pastors came. They watched this, you know, video clip. And you know, we're thinking like, wow, God is working miraculously and wonderfully. Anyways, three pastors gathered together during the break. And they asked me, God is so horrible. Why? Because those four original eggs, they all died. So God didn't take care of them. So if you translate or interpret God in a moral way, with a moral standard, you know, you judge God in a moral way. Well, that has nothing to do with God's original will, but then you apply your own will and saying that, you know, those four eggs were not supposed to die, you know. You know, when you read the Job in the Bible, God asked Job, when the lions are hungry, who gives them food? Who feeds them? Well, to me, in my own opinion, you know, this hungry lion is there. You You know, there are animals, okay, which is, are going to be the prey for the lion. You know, most of the times, dead or the old animals, they become the prey of the lions. But if you say, like, but they are dying, you know, because, you know, lions are going to eat them up. Well, then, you know, this is serious. You know, there are many ways of interpretation, but if you just say, like, if you question, like, die and live, in the aspect of human beings, it's not all. You know, when we get closer to God, let's say I'm going to America in a few days. Before, let's say, I shouldn't have this airplane crash or something. But me, these days, well, if there is airplane crash, then, you know, I die. Well, God sends me to, you know, spread the gospel, but so I don't think this airplane is not going to have an airplane accident. But if there's going to be an airplane accident, that's fine. Well, just because I die, God does something wrong. It's not like that. So the God's life level and our moral way of life level is different. Some denominations, they only emphasize on the legalism or the behavior. So they approach the behavioral research. So they become focused on the righteousness by work. So this is more like the moralism, not the life focus. When you study that, now pastors, theologians, study theology with all the science, facts, and everything, and open your eyes to see how God is working miraculously and wonderfully. When you say miraculously and wonderfully, fearfully, do not stop to reach the level of just the definition of the word, but you have to reach to the spiritual level to understand this. You know, every day I'm looking for all this kind of facts, and I combine with, you know, God's work. And I told my patients to understand that God works on our genes and then heals all the diseases. I have to tell them, okay, these facts and the truth to them so that they understand that they need Jesus, they need true life. When the love of Jesus comes to our body, it becomes the electric current. Ellen G. White, she said, Gospel Ministry, page 43, she said, when the Lord passed by the towns and villages, he radiated life and joy like life waves. You know, Jesus, he was filled with the Spirit of God. So when he passed by the towns and the villages, you know, he radiated life and joy like life waves. So when we get closer to him, yes, we have this, you know, endorphin dunes are turned on and we have this endorphins. Testimonies, Treasures, Volume 2, page 52. We have read this one before. You know, Danny Hinn? He emphasized the power of healing, the blessings of the healing. Whenever he goes, you know, he touched their forehead or something and they all fell. And he performs this miraculous work for the blessings of healing. You know, we shouldn't just judge that, that's, you know, all made up. But Danny Hill respects Catherine Kuhlman. Benny Hinn, when Benny Hinn hits, you know, people's forehead, you know, this person can convey this electric current to the other person, and that person, you know, fell. You know, and that electric current, the voltage and the frequencies, can be written by the computer, and then can be saved on the computer. So with that Benny Hinn's frequencies, you store it on the computer, and then the computer, the machine, if the computer restores or the save the electric power, then if this stored machine is touch the patient, then the patient will get healed. Why? Because Benny Hinn is doing it through this electric waves. This is all about. And the people who are with the Benny Hinn, they're working on this machine thing with the electric waves. You know, at the airport, at the same time, you get passed through this one door, and then you have this, you know, tick, 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 you know, things, and you see, and they say you're safe, and you pass. So it's like when the machine stored Benny Hinn's, you know, this electric power or waves, you know, they have, if they develop this machine, when the patient gets into that machine, you know, that patient gets healed. So you don't need New Start anymore because the waves heals. To demolish this New Start, Satan's working on, you know, with people. You know, this Testimony Treasures of Volume 252 was about this. These satanic agents claim to cure disease. They attribute their power to electricity, magnetism, or the so-called sympathetic remedies, while in truth they are but channels for Satan's electric currents. By this means, he casts his spell over the bodies and souls of men. You know, that's why we talked about this electric currents. Education 104, The showers of rain must refresh the thirsty fields. The sun must impart warmth. Electricity must be conveyed to the buried seed. Sister White, she didn't even know this at that old time, but then she used this word, electricity must be conveyed to the buried seed. The life which the Creator has implanted, which is genes, He alone can call forth. When I read this, I was saying, she is a prophet, because people usually, they don't think in this way. Who thinks it this way? She said, life, there is a gene which, you know, God has implanted, and now we all know that there is genes, okay? And that genes should be turned on to sprout. But then back in old time, even though she didn't know all this, you know, scientific facts, she wrote that the life which the Creator has implanted, He alone can call forth. And he said, even just a little beans, you know, need the power of God to be called forth. Every seed grows, every plant develops by the power of God. That's what she said in Education, page 104. This education, the book of education, she teaches to depend on God 100%, perfectly. She tells us to depend on God perfectly. Testimony Treasures, volume 2, page 100. Nothing but the life-giving influences of the gospel can help the soul. Pray that the mighty energies of the Holy Spirit, with all their quickening, recuperative, and transforming power, may fall like an electric shock on the palsy-stricken soul, causing every nerve to thrill with new life, restoring the whole man from his dead, earthly, sensual state to spiritual soundness. Testimonies for the Churches, Church, Volume 3, 50 and 51 says, intemperance of any kind benumbs the perceptive organs and so weakens the brain, nerve power that eternal things are not appreciated, but placed upon a level with the common, the higher powers of the mind designed for elevated purposes are brought into slavery to the baser passions. If our physical habits are not right, our mental and moral powers cannot be strong, for great sympathy exists between the physical and the moral. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 3, page 50-51. Well, if you say, well, spiritual level, we should be strong, but you say biological level, it's okay, just be strong with the spiritual level. Well, actually, no, that's not right, because those two are connected. Well, if you misunderstand this, you become legalistics. Here, great sympathy exists between the physical and the moral. Let's go back to our autoimmune disease. You remember that our brain, the interaction or relation between the brain and the T cells? Now, T cell originally, they're designed to protect our body. In the T cells, There's a program to maintain our life. There's a program, or God's plan, which is genes, are there to protect ourselves. Somehow the genes are changed, and you know, our T cells attack ourselves, because T cells, the program, the genes are broken or damaged or changed. Why? How? You can answer to this question. Anybody can answer to this question? You know, T cells are influenced by where? Yes, the brain. And the brain is influenced by what? Yes, the spirit. So T cell is influenced by what we think. University of Pittsburgh, they have this research. You know, final situation, cancer patients, they have many difficulties. And the modern medicine, they cannot treat them. So those final situation cancer patients, they all get depressed and they become very discouraged and they all, you know, gradually die. So, you know, okay, now this person will die, so why don't we have this experiment before he dies? Well, let's make a treatment at least before he dies. So, you know, they decided to use this T cells because they cannot treat them with the medication. At least they knew that T cell is under this mind or the thinking of the person. So they decided to have this experiment. So, okay, let's enhance the power of the T cell, which is you know, like I said before, psychoimmunology. They started to work on the psychoimmunology. According to the psychoimmunology, let's enhance the function of the T cell. So they hired the psychologists, and those psychologists, you know, they say 12 is the good number, so 12 patients are the good number of the group, can share each other and encourage each other and, you know, things like that. So this psychologist came and they met a group, 12 patients, cancer, final situation patients gathered together. So they said, okay, now, you know, your T cells influenced by your thinking. So we're going to practice this positive imaginary therapy. Positive imagery therapy. We're going to practice positive imagery therapy to enhance your T cells so that your T cells can, you know, destroy your cancer cells. This is what the psychologists say. And how? Let's hold our hands. Let's hold our hands. You know, 12 of you, hold your hands. And then let's actively imagine. That, let's imagine that your T cells are the seagulls. And your cancer cells in your body, that's the fish. Okay, just imagine that. And then now these seagulls all came and they started to eat the fish. Okay, imagine that, that the seagulls come and then they eat the fish. Which means, you know, your T cell is eating up your, you know, cancer cells. Okay, so this is what the psychologist is saying. She's, you know, operating this class in this way. Now you guys hold your hands and now close your eyes and imagine that you're on the sand beach and you hear the seagull and that you hear the wave, you know, you know, and you're on that nice beach. And imagine that in the middle of the sea, the group of fish came, okay? And you see the seagulls came, and they're going to eat all the fish. You know, you have this sound of the seagulls, you know, through the tape recorder. And the psychologist said, you know, this is, these seagulls are thousands of them, and thousands, hundreds and thousands of the seagulls came. They're going to eat the fish. This is what? This is like the health. This is the self-hypnotism. So they imagine that, you know, seagulls are eating those fish, and now your T cell is eating up your cancer cells. So the psychologists encourage them actively to imagine this. So they practice this 1 hour a day, all week. So the scientists, they took the blood out of the patients, and the size of the cancer cells got smaller. And then the function of the T cell improved. So they thought, wow, then we can conquer the cancer. This is the right therapy to conquer the cancer, they thought in the beginning. So they thought, okay, so if we keep practicing this for 2 weeks, then the cancer cells will all gone. Let's say there was like 8 centimeters the size, okay? And after a week, it became 4 centimeters, like half size. So it was the second week, and they practiced. But then, however, this 4 centimeters size became 3 centimeters. And the third week practicing, this cancer cell didn't go away. It didn't shrink. And then the fourth week, it started to get bigger somehow. Why is that? The size got smaller in the beginning, you know, really quickly, but then slowed down. But then it grew instead of getting smaller. Why is that? You know, mannerism. You know, these patients, they didn't appreciate or they didn't realize the truth. What they did is just to closing their eyes and just imagine that the you know seagulls came and then, you know, ate the fish. You know, if they just kept imagining. But if you keep imagining, you get tired, you're bored, because you don't learn anything. If I were a patient, if I practiced this for 2 weeks, you would think, I have to go there again and practice that seagull stuff. You know, so that's why. You know, human efforts, there's limitation. You know, there's a law that God has implanted. You know, we want to use our own way, but then it doesn't work. There's a limitation. When the patients come to the New Start, they hear the messages of God and the truth of God. You know, I give them lecture, and they listen. And I say, the Word of God, the love of God, and the Word of God changes the genes, and you will be healed. You know, I give them this main core with many different stories. Food is different, and they have, you know, infrastructure. They practice the infrastructure, which is a new start, and they listen to the truth and the Word of God. And then the genes, you know, get changed and they get better. You know, this just positive imagery therapy, there's no truth in that therapy. There's no beauty. There's no goodness. There's no truth in that therapy. It's just a practicing. It's just a treatment. And that's why it didn't work. There is no spirit in the therapy. This is like, you know, the wolf and the shepherd, You know, when the shepherd cries, like, there's wolf! And then all the villagers came to help this sheep and the shepherd. But the second day, the shepherd cries again, there is a wolf! And then half of the villagers came, and but they realize that they're fooled. Now, if the shepherd keeps saying that there is wolf and there is wolf, then you know, the shepherd will be scolded by the villagers. You know, you need to have truth in that. You need to have God in it instead of human efforts. If there is only human efforts, there's nothing. Again, I say, our T cells react to the way of thinking. Way of our thinking. Now, I'm sure there are many autoimmune disease patients in your church, especially women. You know, your T cells are changed because they're influenced by your brain, which is the way of thinking. So when those patients, you know, we know that, you know, this is what the autoimmune disease is about. Now, when you go to the hospital, now the hospital gives you what? They give you this special medication to destroy your T cells. That is the only way that the modern medicine can provide. Why? Because T cells, they attack your knees, and now your knees are swollen, and you have this rheumatoid, and you cry, and you feel pain, so much pain. And the doctors, what they can do? They have to relieve your pain. Now, these pains are caused by your changed T cells. So what they can do, they can just kill your T cells. They can only give you this immune suppressor, you know, medication only, so that your T cells, you know, die. When the T cells, you know, die, of course your symptoms got better. But what happened after that? If you keep destroying your T cells, then what happened? You have high ratio of getting other cancers or different more serious diseases. Well, you shouldn't destroy all of your T cells. You know, even though you destroy your T cells, somehow, you know, because of the grace of God, you know, T cells are made every day. Now you say, oh, your symptoms got better. Okay, so you say, oh, I'm not gonna take medicine anymore. But you know, you have new T cells, and the new T cells, they're changed. Okay, so they attack your knees again. And then now what? And then you have this, you know, symptoms. So you take the medicine, and then what? Again, you destroy your T cells. So it's been, you know, circulating. You know, it repeats. I'm not saying that you shouldn't take the medication. What I want to say, you know, when there is a very acute, you know, pain or the problem or symptoms, yes, you should take medicine, but this is not all. This immune suppressor medication doesn't heal your immune autoimmune disease. And the hospital gives you medication, and then you take the medication, you get, you know, your symptoms get better, but then, you know, so you stop taking it, but then you get sick again, and then you take medicine. You know, it repeats, but that's not all. And then you go like, oh, Ellen G. White says, you know, stop, you know, we shouldn't take medicine. So you say, okay, then let's, you know, practice New Start instead of taking medicine. But then, you know, remember, you know, when you practice New Start, you should practice New Start in the spiritual level, not the flesh level. Like, you practice New Start, and if you think New Start is just a vegetarian diet, then you will feel bored with this New Start. It's like, ah, why am I, you know, having this vegetarian diet, okay? Why am I so unlucky, unfortunate to have this kind of disease? If you have this kind of idea, this is very flesh. So even though you practice New Start, you don't get better. It's like the same with the positive imagery therapy. So, you know, some of the Adventists, they practice New Start like those patients who are practicing the positive imagery therapy. We just do the formal, that we just do the frames. There's no content in it. Because you just keep practicing New Start, but you feel bored. It's not in the spiritual level of practice. So you get sick even though you practice New Start. Usually a lot of women, they suffer from autoimmune disease. Now, let's say, you know, our thinking, our mind changes our genes, T cells, and then, you know, the T cells are changed because of this way of thinking. That what kind of thinking is that? Yeah, of course, men, they also suffer from autoimmune disease, but those men usually, they're very feminine. You know, me, I am also this feminine, so I had this rheumatoid before. But after I practiced New Start, I'm fine. When I say, you know, feminine, is when I say feminine is like you endure and you press down your thinking and you try hard not to hurt other people. So pastors, they have high, you know, possibilities to get this autoimmune disease because there are many times that they press down, okay, themselves. Introverted people. I was very introverted, but as I, you know, get to know God, I have this full of energy and I, you know, I get, you know, joyful, and so I could speak in front of people. And I pray and I talk to God. So, you know, I got more open-minded. Let's say, you know, when you have conflict with your spouse, you know, you just suppress it down, but then you have it in your heart. But then the garbage, those, you know, bad thinking, you can take it out. You know, God takes all the garbage for us. Nobody takes the garbage for me, but then God, Jesus, takes my garbage.
안 버려, 안 버려. 안 버리고 혼자서 해결하고 하나님 앞에 가서 다 해결했습니다. 이렇게 내가 얼마나 열심히 잘 해결했는지 보고 드리는 그런 신앙 관계.
You know, usually people say they don't take those garbage out, but they say, you know, I try and try and try. And when they go to God, they say, I did that, I did this, and things are solved. So that's like the report to God instead of asking Him to solve the problem. Now, let's say there is this very nice daughter-in-law, okay? She got married. This is Korean situation, tradition. Now, she got married, and she's very, very nice, and everybody thinks she's very sweet and kind. So even though she meets her friends, she cannot say bad things about people, you know, like the mother-in-law, the in-law family's things. You know, people, even though they don't take this garbage, you know, to God, garbage out to God, Jesus, but then usually people take this garbage. It's like the gossiping, okay? In other words, gossip, okay? They gossip, you know, with friends. This is not the spiritual level, but this is a moral level. Somehow, this daughter-in-law, she couldn't even talk about it. She couldn't speak ill of her mother-in-law with her friends because everybody thinks she's nice. You know, when you press down and press down, okay, then your genes receive these signals from head, and then T cells, you know, gather, and then they have this meeting. You know, this person wants to die, and why don't we cooperate with this person? You know, they have this meeting. Well, these kind of things happen. So genes in the T cells, they decided to help this patient because this patient wanted to die. So according to this person's will, they cause disease. Now, let's say this Christian goes to church, you know, sincerely, but then this person has this moral Christianism. This person is so obsessed not to sin. It's like, oh, I shouldn't sin, I shouldn't sin. You know, after this person sins, like, oh, I'm sorry, God, I'm sorry, God. And this person has this guilty feeling. So this person is so afraid of sinning. So those people think like that way. So that is kind of, you know, that is righteousness by work. And these people think, you know, children, they don't sin. So that's why they say, that's why we should be like children. That's how they understand. You know, fear cannot make you clean. When you say you're clean, you're purified, when you are totally soaked in the love of God and the grace of God, and when you live by the grace of God, it's very easy to repent. It's like, Dad, I made a mistake again. Or else, you know, this person is like, you know, you sin again, you should repent. Not that kind of relationship. But then you go to God, oh, God, Dad, I made a mistake again. Dad, I don't know why. Please help me. Please, God. And then God, you know, hugs, you know, this child. And it's like, don't worry. You know, even though you make a mistake, my love doesn't change. Believe in this, you know, my love. So don't worry about it. And then the child says, oh, Dad, I will be more careful. Dad, I'll try again. you know, that kind of relationship with God. But you just can't do it when you are obsessed by this righteousness by work. Now, when you sin, you have this guilty feeling, and you feel like you're going to be punished, and you need to be punished. You know, a lot of Catholics, they think this way, oh, God is going to punish me because I did this. And they have this fear because they have done wrong. This is, you know, guilty feeling. These guilty feelings change your genes. And then you have this autoimmune disease. This is the spiritual level. Now, let's say this person is very cheerful. Let's say this is another case. Now, this person is very cheerful, but then somehow this person is workaholic. This person works and works and works, doesn't sleep, and works. And then when this person works, it's got to be perfect. So perfectionism. You know, this person pushes, you know, themselves and they work and work. And then, you know, T cells in that person's body, T cells, they think, oh, this person wants to die. So the thought and the lifestyle influences the state of genes. Now, other lifestyle, workaholic, other than workaholic, it's like the food. This person eats all the bad, junky food, okay? Then the T cells think, oh, this person wants to, you know, hurt the cells, so this person wants to die. So that's how, well, this is the theory of the autoimmune disease, how it goes. Well, me, practically, I experienced this, so I'm going to explain what I have experienced before we finish. You know, there are many patients, you know, autoimmune disease patients, but I still remember this person. Her name was Angela. She's a Catholic. And the Catholic Church, there's a man who is very handsome, rich, generous, and sweet, and tall and all nice, you know, the number one qualified. Qualified man. Now, Angela, she's also number one, you know, lady. Now, Angela likes this man, but somehow this man is quite old, but somehow this man is still single even though he's old. Even though this man is wonderful and qualified, but he's still single. Is why? Because his mother is very, very terrible, okay? His mother had a very bad character. That's why this man was still single. And now Angela, even though she likes this man, but of course she knew about, she heard about, you know, his mother, so, you know, she hesitated many times. But then Angela said, finally, I'm going to get married to him. And then Angela's mother said, are you going to die? You know his mother. And then Angela said, Mom, I'm going to pray, and God told me that he's going to protect. And God told me to change his mother. This is the mission that I received, so I have to go. You know, I have to get married. So Angela's mother, she was saying, no, no, no. Of course, Angela's mom is a very religious mother. And, you know, Angela's mother, you know, heard that, you know, her daughter got this mission from God and so forth. So Angela's mom allowed, permitted. So Angela got married to this man. And Angela, you know, they got married, right? And then Angela's mom, I mean the man's mother, when she met Angela, took Angela as her daughter-in-law, the first comment that his mother said was, "So you're gonna try to change me, hey? That's what I was told. Okay, let's see how you can change me, okay?" So Angela, you know, but she just kept praying and praying. But 3 months later, Angela was exhausted. Angela burned out, and she couldn't cope up with his mother. So, you know, Angela treated his mother very well, but somehow his mother, of course, was very bad and, you know, very bad to her daughter-in-law continuously. So Angela gave up on her mother-in-law. So this mother-in-law realized that Angela kind of gave up on her. You know, of course, being nice, she's nice, but then not that nice like before. So Angela's mother-in-law got really upset, and she bothered Angela more, even worse. And so this mother-in-law got really upset and angry easily, and, you know, things like that. So she got a stroke because she was very stressed. She got hypertension, and one day she got a stroke. And one of the part of her brain controlling the language part, she had the problem. She got stroke there. So she couldn't speak very well. You know, to speak well or to pronounce correctly, all the muscles and the neurons and everything should work together. And that is worked. You know, the neurons actually control those things, right? Nobody controls their neurons, you know? Birds sing, okay? And the scientists observed that the same kinds of birds, they sing the same thing. Of course, they have different messages, they have different songs, but you know, there's a song, the center of the song. If the center is broken, if the center is damaged, the birds cannot sing. Now, you know, I talk, you know, I speak, but it's not what I am doing. But our language part, our language center, okay, is controlled by God, because God controls these neurons in my head. I am speaking. You know, so we say like God gives us words to speak, right? That is correct. You know, Satan can give this thought to Judah's head. God gives us these words to witness Jesus Christ. We don't have to worry about what we're going to say at the court, because God is going to give us the word. That's very practical, and that's the realistic. Now, if you know this, you don't have to worry, because, well, God, you promised that you're going to give me the words. Well, I trust you. I'll go to the court. Please walk with me. And then you speak, because God will give you the word. Well, do not believe this religiously only, but scientifically it works. So this, you know, Angela's mother-in-law, her brain neurons got damaged, so she couldn't speak. She wanted to speak, but then because the neurons are damaged, she couldn't speak. Well, God couldn't work with the neurons because the neurons were damaged. It's the same with the birds. It's not your voice only, your vocal cord, it's not your mouth, but the spirit touches it and the neurons worked and then now you speak. That's how it is. That's the process. So this mother-in-law couldn't speak. If Angela were a bad woman, she would think, well, served you right, mother-in-law. You troubled me so much and now served you right. You got a stroke? Okay. Now I'm not going to take care of you. I'm not going to take care of you, but I'm going to hire someone to take care of you. But you know, Angela, she's such a good, you know, woman, and she's very sweet. But so instead of thinking that way, but she felt guilty. Why? Because she gave up on her, right? So she felt guilty. So she prayed to God, oh God, please help me and save me. Don't punish me. I'll be better. Okay, I'll be better to her. I'll treat her better than before. She had this kind of moral way of faith. So from that day, she decided to treat her mother-in-law better, you know, because she promised to God. She takes care of her. She has to bathe her. She gave her the bath, and she has to take care of, you know, all the everything. You know, when she goes into her mother-in-law's room, she couldn't speak, but she gives her all the bad, you know, frequencies. And Angela, of course, could feel that waves, right? So, but she did that. You know, one day, Angela was feeding her mother-in-law. And then, you know, stroke patients, you know, they cannot really swallow very well. So the food, you know, drooled. So this Angela, you know, she wiped, okay, her mouth. But then her mother-in-law actually bit her hand. So because she was so surprised and it was so hurt, so she slapped her cheek. And now Angela got even worse. Angela felt so guilty because she slapped her cheek. She promised to God that she'll treat her mother-in-law well, but then, you know, she just did it. So Satan whispered her that you are done now, Angela. You're done. God is going to punish you. So Angela believed that God is going to punish me. Have you ever waited to be punished? You know, I was tall when I was young, okay? And usually when teachers do this corporal punishment, you know, they start to, you know, hit the kids like from the shortest one. So I was the tallest one, so I had to wait to be hit. So every time, you know, we were scolded or we were punished, I want to be the first one to be punished. Now Angela, you know, she is waiting to be punished and she wanted to get punished earlier. So she's waiting and waiting to be punished. And then T-cells, they're saying, oh, she wants to be punished. And then T-cells attack her knees, and then she got rheumatoid, and her husband got surprised. So he took her to the hospital, and then of course they gave her the immune suppressor medication, so she couldn't digest, and you know, side effects got, you know, worse. And then Angela, she didn't want to go to hospital. Why? Because she knows this is from God and she's punished from God. So, you know, I don't want to even go to the hospital. You know, of course, you know, the husband is very rich. So her husband took her to America. And then her husband took her to the Harvard University and the Harvard Hospital, University Hospital. But then the situation is about the same. So they got discouraged, and it was about to finish. Treating in the hospital. And then somehow God sends her the angel. Angela somehow got to know this Seventh-day Adventist. And this Seventh-day Adventist introduced Weimar, New Start movement in Weimar, to Angela. And the husband says, oh, so Seng Li is in Weimar. So this husband took his wife to Weimar. And then, of course, husband had to go back to his work, so went back to Korea. Now, I listened to Angela's talk. I wanted to encourage her, and I wanted to give her the hope. So I said, well, it's very difficult to live with in-laws' family, huh? And usually, normally, patients, they say, yeah, it's very difficult, it's very difficult. And sometimes they cry. But then Angela somehow, she said, no, no, living with in-laws family is fine. It means she's good, she's kind. And I told her that, well, I was told that your husband said your mother-in-law is a very difficult person. But then Angela, she said, oh, no, no, she's not. She's not a difficult person to live with. You know, she was very hypocrite in morally, immoral. So I thought, it is going to be very difficult to talk to her. So I said, God, I don't know how to approach her. Please give me wisdom. We need to have something common. Please help me. And God told me that, okay, speak to her with the word of God. So I asked, what kind of words? And then God sent me this word, guilty feeling, guilty. You know, I think she is just, she has this guilty feelings, but that she doesn't want to show. So I show her this Bible verse, Luke chapter 6, verse 35, love your enemies, do good to them, for he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. Here, God is kind to the wicked. In Angela's idea, God is kind to the good, but God punishes the wicked. That was her idea. But then now she reads this, he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. She was surprised when she read this Bible verse. It was the moment that the character of God is changed in her. I told you the character of God is life. Now, the character of God that Angela knew and the character of God in the Bible were different. So she read the Bible again, and she looked at it again, and she read the Bible again. She looked at the Bible for a long time, and she sighed. Yeah, relief. That was the sigh of her relief. She was relieved. But she didn't speak. She didn't say what crossed her mind. She looked at me for a long time, and then she read the Bible again, and then she sighed. Her complexion has changed. Serotonin started to be produced. Her state of mind become peaceful. Beta wave changed into alpha wave. The word gave her the true character of God, true character of Jesus Christ. So I said, thank you, Lord. And then? I showed her another verse. How Jesus treated Judas. Matthew 26. Matthew 26, verse 20, when it was evening, Jesus sat down at the table with the 12 disciples. At the time, of course, Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him. And I said, do you think Jesus knew already at this time that Judas going to betray him? And she said, yes. And I said, you know, Angela, if I were Jesus, I would sit with 11 disciples. I wouldn't sit with Judas. But here, Jesus, he invited Judas in that table. And then Angela was surprised again. What does it mean theologically? If you're going to write the thesis on about this 12 disciples, does it have any meaning? You would say, well, 12 disciples, you sit with him because he has 12 disciples. But it's not that. Not the theory, but the spiritual level of understanding is needed. You know, here Jesus sat down at the table with the 12 disciples. It didn't have great meaning when we approach this theologically only, but look at the character of Jesus Christ in this Bible verse. So I don't like studying theology academically, but I want to see the character of Jesus which is shining in every verse and every word. Verse 21, Matthew chapter 26, 21 again, here. While they were eating, he said, I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me. Here Jesus said, I tell you the truth. The truth. That one word expresses the character of Jesus. If there's no word like the truth, if the Bible verse says, I tell you, one of you will betray me, it's not like that. Here it says, I verily, verily say it to you. I tell you the truth. I verily, verily say it to you. One of you will betray me. That character you need to prove. That makes people live. That is life theology. This is the character theology. This is the essence of theobiology. We should make people live through the word of God. Verse 22, greatly distressed, each one asked in turn, am I the one, Lord? And Jesus said, no, 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 no. And this is Judas' turn. Verse 25, Judas, the one who would betray him, also asked, Rabbi, am I the one? Jesus told him, you have said it. He said, yes, it's you. And then what happens instantly? Yes, salvation. Right after, as they're... As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take this bread and eat it, for this is my body." And in verse 28 it says, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people." Here, verse 27, God says, "Each of you, all of you, drink from it." And I talked to Angela that if I were Jesus, I would say, you drink it. Judah, you're out. And then Angela, she was touched. Wow. You know, she said, without knowing, she said, "Me too? I can drink it too?" That was the moment that she accepted the true character of Jesus Christ. She thought she was out. She thought she's not qualified to take this cup of forgiveness. She listened to the false testimonies from Satan. She said, "Including me." So I said, "Yes." Jesus said, "All of you." And that word, "all," you are included. She started to cry. Holding my hand, she cried. She wept. "Jesus Christ, thank you, Lord. Jesus, thank you. God, thank you." Electric shock was flowing. All the genes started to work. Very strong restoration was happening inside of her body. When the love of God spreads out inside of our body, when the strong electric shock is flowing through your body, you feel it in the body. When you experience it, you know this is it. She starts to cry and cry and crying. "Thank you, doctor. Thank you, doctor. I think I met Jesus today." I have believed God and I went to the Catholic Church all this time, but I didn't know the true character of God. Even though I slept my mother-in-law's cheek, you know, God sent me to this New Start Center to save me. And then she started to cry again and again, and "Thank you, Lord," and "Thank you, Lord." That moment is the moment of life. That moment is the moment that the Holy Spirit is working. That is the moment that the Holy Spirit is turning on all the genes. You know what happened to the T cells? Of course, yes. You already know. Now, the spirit of death spirit went away. Now the spirit of life came to her, and now she practices New Start and studies the Bible with her tears. And she realized that her thinking was useless. She wanted to change her mother-in-law, but that was wrong, and she realized it. You know, genes, you know, they can be changed into normal, of course, right? So, do you know what happened to her genes? Her genes all got, you know, recovered. Now, in Korea, his mother-in-law met this person, like helper, to take care of her. And then this, you know, caring person hit her all the time because this mother-in-law couldn't speak. So when the mother-in-law, you know, does, you know, those wicked things, you know, this helper hit her all the time. So this, you know, mother-in-law thinks that, "Oh, because I am bad, you know, this is what I'm treated." Now Angela came back to Korea, and Angela got, of course, healed, and said, "Oh, mother-in-law, I'm going to take care of you. We don't need to hire this person anymore. I'm going to take care of you." Now this mother-in-law heard what Angela said she started to cry and cry. The love of Christ came to Angela, came into Angela's heart, and that God gets into the mother-in-law's heart. Now, Angela received the Spirit of Jesus Christ, and she sends this life waves to the mother-in-law. So they practice New Start together. Now, this mother-in-law listens to the Word of God and the story of Jesus together with Angela. Now, Angela, you know, makes this brown rice, all the nice vegetarian diet and all things. Now, mother-in-law could speak. And mother-in-law could walk. And mother-in-law came to church, and they got baptized together. Now, this is New Start. Through the Word of God, not through the vegetarian diet. We shouldn't glorify vegetarian diet, but we should know that Jesus Christ is the healer. He's the only healer. I think there are many possibilities of false healing in our church even. You know, you have this diet, vegetarian diet, and you get healed. And this is vegetarian message. And you get healed because you practice this vegetarian diet. This is false healing. I met this very spiritual pastor in our denomination. I had a conversation with him. This pastor didn't know what true New Start was. Because this pastor didn't know, this spiritual pastor didn't know the true New Start, he let himself to the human hand. So I told him, you don't know what true New Start is. Because he didn't know what true New Start is. He practiced this therapy and that therapy and this therapy. But somehow I told him, you should practice the true New Start, but this pastor didn't listen to me. Well, of course, we shouldn't stop in this level that spiritual pastors even didn't know what true New Start is. We shouldn't stop in this level. There's a beautiful story about this. And remember, Jesus Christ is a great physician and he's the only healer. That thought should be practically work in the leaders of the church, which is pastor's heart. And when the pastors have this in their hearts, surely then the true revelation, true reformation will work, will happen in our denomination.